Thanks you very much for the invitation. Great event. I could only could not join all talks, unfortunately, but great that this initiative is going on, and great to see so much research in response to the crisis that we're facing all over the world. So I would like to shift gears a bit, not towards the actual presentation of algorithms that have been developed based on image data, but an effort to try to build databases to build diagnostic and prognostic algorithms, because we feel there's a real need now for developing such databases. In a way, I think this crisis also has given us new opportunities, because we realize now how important it is for coping with this enormous pressure on the healthcare system, with good information and learning from data and doing AI, and having good access to data is crucial there. And one thing I hope is that some of the efforts we're seeing that are happening now in order to make data available for research will help us in other disease areas as well, and that also a number of good things will come of this crisis. So just go to the next slide. As a disclosure, I'm also involved next to my academic position in a spin-off company, Quantib, although we don't have any efforts in the field of COVID. So none of what I'm presenting today in the presentation is linked to activities in the company. So I think many of you work in the domain of AI and trying to learn from image data, relate image data to outcomes. And we've seen that these learning systems have been quite disruptive, and especially tasks like segmentation and classification are now done best if you have access to a large set of data. Still, if we are critical, the translation of this to clinical practice has been slow, and the reason is probably that we don't need image data alone in order to make a good diagnosis or a prognosis. And there's quite some challenges if you really want to implement AI in a very broad setting. So I think challenges we see in the health domain to really bring AI types of efforts towards the clinic is that only analyzing the images is not what we need. Often we have to take into account much more information and relate it to outcomes. And that means we need to collect much more than the images, and collecting data in a good fashion and making them accessible to learn from is a challenge. Then we see that human biology and pathology is highly variable. And if we collect data, data bias is very much a challenge. So if in the end we want to develop technologies that we really want to implement, the question really is if the outbreak that was starting in China, if we could learn from data from Chinese patients, can we utilize the same data at the moment that the pandemic arrives at the Netherlands, for example, or should we have specific data from our own databases, because there may be some biases in the data. And we see that as a really a big challenge for introduction these techniques on a global scale. And in the end, also, it's very important that techniques are integrated into the workflow seamlessly. So one of the things we've realized is really to make the promise of AI into impact in society, we need to start to work on a health data infrastructure in which all data can be reused. And in the Netherlands, we have started to make this a national effort in which we connect all institutes that are collecting data, be it both for research or for clinical practice, and to start to think about harmonization of data for reuse for research and innovation. So what we try to tackle is the enormous fragmentation we see of data, images, and samples, both in the healthcare chain and in research. The enormous lack of standardization in care and research, which make it difficult to reuse the data for AI development and validation. This resulting in the reliability and quality and reusability of data being poor. Also, and this may be different in different parts of the world, but definitely in Europe, there's a lot of unclarity. Sometimes there's much more possible that people realize. So whether it's correct or not, but there is a lot of concern under what conditions actually we can learn from data for AI solutions, what is needed in terms of consent, etc. So these are things that are sometimes obstructive for really trying to develop methods based on databases. So that's the reason for us in the Netherlands to start HealthRI, and this is not just an isolated national initiative. Of course, we want to connect to other initiatives around the world to be able to learn from data on a larger scale. If you look at the way we organized HealthRI, it's on the one hand a political organization. We lobby towards the government to ensure that the laws are in place and the policies and the finance in order to be able to reuse data for research. Then we want to actually build a data infrastructure. I will say a little bit more about it later in the talk, but the crucial part of that infrastructure is that locally we support healthcare institutes to make their data available. And that means that they make their data fair, which means they are findable, accessible, interoperable, and reusable. And that we connect them with a system which allows for distributed access and distributed learning. And then the idea is, if you do that, you want to support both researchers and innovators in order to access the data. So you want to build a portal for people to get access to these data sets. So in a way, it has been quite a challenge to build such a health data infrastructure. And what you see is often that it's easier to fund a specific research project than infrastructure for a research project. And what we've realized on the HealthRI side is that really making sure AI works in the clinic requires infrastructure and an infrastructure investment. And COVID has all of a sudden made this much more clear also for the politicians. So we all of a sudden have a lot of headway, tailwind actually, in order to support the initiative, because people do realize that COVID is going to be around for a while, and that our ability to learn from today's data in order to will be crucial to treat tomorrow's COVID-19 patient better. And what we also see is that there's many, many initiatives now that have started to collect data, address different types of questions. But to collect and find the right data is non-trivial. If I look at my own hospital, I am from the Erasmus Medical Center in Rotterdam, and we have a very well-known virology department. So they are quite active in the field of COVID. And because of that, we have no less than 85 studies that have now been going to the department that checks for ethical and legal reasons whether a certain study can be done, or a certain observational study. So in one hospital alone, we have 85 people that want to do observational studies on the data. And we see the same pattern in other hospitals. So we see great efforts, but also very, very scattered. And we feel some harmonization is needed to really make optimal use of the data. So that's why we, from the HealthRI side, try to connect these initiatives. So obviously, imaging plays a role in there. This is one of the early publications. There's many more publications now. Some of them were referred to in the previous talks. And we see that there's also a lot of interest in what's happening on the molecular scale and why certain patients, for example, obese patients, have a larger chance to get the disease. So it makes a lot of sense if you see the current articles to start to learn from image data combined with clinical data and combined with samples. So what we've done in the Netherlands is first try to provide an overview. This is simply a website of all collections, data infrastructure, initiatives, etc., that are around. Then one of the more important initiatives we think is about the clinical data and about the samples, because especially imaging data in a way is a little bit easier to reuse them. They're already gathered in an electronic fashion, but in the end, we want to link our imaging data to, we want to combine it with clinical data and to clinical outcomes. And what we've seen in previous occurrences of epidemics is that it's often later difficult in order to reuse data. So one of the first things we started to do together with people from the FAIR initiative, and FAIR is this international initiative to make data reusable by adhering to standards and harmonization, is that we started to ensure that wherever data are being collected, we adhere as quickly as possible to the CRF of the World Health Organization, and also that we support institutions to map this ECRF to a machine-readable form such that the data can be reused. So this project, the VODEN project, is linked to the clinical data with the idea that we harmonize at the start as much as possible the type of data that is being collected. And we see now that the cardiologists or the oncologists sometimes want to collect additional information. And the moment they want it, we add it to the CRF and try nationally to coordinate that to ensure that we collect the same type of data at the different institutes so as to be able to share these types of data. We're doing the same with the imaging data. So our idea is that we're not collecting imaging data for a specific study, but that we would like to build an observational database of image data that is being able as a sort of a large database from which different observational studies can be supported. So in the different hospitals, we collect data according to the same ECRF. And if X-ray or CT data are being collected, we want to store these data in an XNet database. We use the same pseudonymization software has been developed by two university medical centers, and we share it between different institutes in a way to pseudonymize the data in the same way. When we pseudonymize the data, we ensure that we give the same ID to the imaging data as the data that are stored in the clinical database, such that we can always link the image data to the clinical data. For example, if we would like to be able to link image data to how long people are at the ICU or what is their chance to be at the ICU, that is still feasible. So in this way, you would like to have the same principle for clinical data, image data, and samples, such that you can reuse them. Also on the European level, people start to work with this concept of a data platform and a data portal. This is a bit more from the molecular field, and there are some European infrastructure initiatives that want to ensure that all kinds of omics data that are being collected in different cohorts can be linked through between the different cohorts. And we are in the process of also linking our image data to these types of efforts, such that in a privacy preserving way, we can connect image data to clinical data, to molecular data. So I think if you think about this concept on the national level, or in this case for the image data, we go to a national database, but by definition, health data are often going to be scattered and be located in different institutes. So the overall concept that we try to build, and which we think hopefully after COVID can be used for many other applications as well, is the combination of harmonization at the source, ensuring we have, and we call them a sort of a local data steward teams that ensure that the image data, samples, and clinical data are collected in a similar form and adhere to a certain data format. And then they are what we call FAIR data stations, and we connect the different institutes in order to be able to access the data, but also start to pilot experiments, like can we optimize a deep learning network with data staying locally as long as the data have been clearly harmonized. So I think this is the direction we want to go, because by definition, data cannot always be pooled in central location. So I think a next important step is, of course, and I think that's what we're seeing now. I think there's a lot of great initiatives and a lot of algorithms are coming out in the COVID space, but it's still difficult to really know what is the quality of certain algorithms and how can a clinical end user know whether an algorithm that has been proposed can work beyond the data for which it is trained. So I think here our community has been very strong in the last 10, 15 years to build the concept of challenges and having objective frameworks to compare algorithms. And I think if we start to think of building databases multi-center together for certain relevant tasks, I think also we should develop proper validation strategies together. And that's intrinsically linked to the databases we are building. So I think if we look at the Grand Challenge website that's maintained at Nijmegen University, you see the great history in the field of medical image analysis now coming from computer vision to develop certain challenges. I think for many use cases, not only in COVID, it would be great if we start to develop these large databases that we always set a certain part of the data apart, and that we define clinically relevant use cases and are able that if we develop, if we provide this database, for example, for innovators and researchers to build algorithms on, we also ask them to utilize the same platform to evaluate their algorithms so that we know what are the strengths and the limitations of algorithms, and we know how we can employ them. Now, I think there's a lot of collaboration needed there. Obviously, it's the companies that bring the eventual solutions to the end user, but I don't think companies can do it alone. This is a very nice paper by Michael Recht et al. From the International Society of Strategic Studies in Radiology that looked at what is really needed in order to bring AI to the clinic, and it really, especially on the part of having sufficient access to the relevant data, but also being able to validate systems in terms of what is needed in clinical practice, it requires co-creation between industry and clinicians. And there's also a crucial role there for academic medical centers, because they have data and the domain knowledge, but they need to co-work with industries in order to bring these solutions to the patient. So I think we see the enormous power of data-driven responses to COVID. We see it in the image domain, we see it in the molecular domain, we see it in the clinical data domain. And I think we have an important role to play there. But I think we also realize now for COVID, but also for all our other research, we are reusing our data too little. And that is because data are too fragmented and difficult to reuse. And I really hope that because of COVID, we're now starting a number of initiatives to share data between institutes, between countries, and between domains, and that this will be a stepping stone to really increase the quality of our research and the quality of the validation. And eventually, I think this will lead to more impact of AI in radiology and beyond. So thank you for your interest.